the Deeper Life Bible Church on Sunday is such an exciting and enriching experience that no one will want to miss. And in this visit, you will be made part of this happy and heaven-bound congregation as you listen to the message. You will never be the same again. Happy listening, and God bless you.
If you have questions on what we have learned today, you can please raise up your hand. Any question from the student section? The hand over there, please.
Good morning, sir. My question is that I have three questions that I want to ask. And my question is that I want to ask, how can we, maybe as a youth, because there are many of these youth in our schools, and I want to know that, how can we, because many of these youth, they are hardening in their hearts, and many of them, they have been hearing the word of God. And I want to know that, how can we approach these youth, so that when we tell them about the word of God, because many of them, when we want to speak to them, they will not want to listen to us, they will just shun us off. So I want to ask, how can we approach these youth so that they will be able to listen to us? And I also want to know that maybe someone, you as a Christian, you have been listening to the word of God and you have not been preaching to the people in the past, and as a result of that, many youth have failed. I want to know that maybe if you repent of your of that negligence and you ask God to forgive you, will the blood of those people still be required at your hand? And I also want to know that maybe you have been serving the Lord before and you have preached to many souls, and maybe you backslided or you went to sin, because the Bible says that it's only those that overcome, and if you preach the gospel, you will receive a crown. And I want to know that maybe that person will still receive the reward at the end. That is my question.
Now, our sister wants to know, if you are a child of God, but you are young, and you have other students around you, how do you approach them so that they will receive the word of God while you preach to them? In Proverbs chapter 11 verse 30, Proverbs 11 verse 30, the fruit of the righteous is the tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. Here the righteous is compared to a tree bearing fruit. And if we know anything about young people in particular, they like fruit. And when they see trees that are not very, very high and tall, and those trees have low, low branches, and they have good fruits that they can pick, we know that naturally those children, young people, will get near those trees having the low branches, and they will pick the fruits that are sweet out of the branches of the tree. Which tells us young Christians who are born again are compared to trees, but they're not very, very tall, they're not very, very high, they're not very, very far away from other children like themselves. Their own branches are very low, and the fruits can easily be seen, and the fruits are very, very near. And if you are a child, you are in the school, and you have classmates, they see that you are quiet, they see that you are loving, they see that you are generous, they see that you are not boisterous, aggressive, violent, they see that you never fight, and they see the fruit of the Spirit in your life. Because your tree is not very, very tall, and it's very near them, they like that fruit as well. When they see the love, and the joy, and the peace, and the goodness, and the gentleness, and the humility, and the self-control, you are not a talkative. And they see the fruit of the Spirit in your life, that fruit will attract them. So, the best way for a child to attract another child to the Lord, it's not just by talking and talking and talking. There are many young people that can talk a lot, and they can preach a lot, but their fruits are so bitter. And those bitter fruits in their life will drive the people away from them. And no matter how long you preach, if the fruit is not sweet and there is no peace emanating coming out of your life, you are going to drive other young people away. So the first thing you do is live right, behave well, be a child of God. Let the people see Christ in you. And then it says, he that winneth souls is wise. Such a child, already bearing the fruit, and the branches are low, and the other children can reach forth, and even want to ask you questions. Now you need to be wise. How do you apply the wisdom? You look at the needs of the children. And if you can be of help to that child, you will be of help. That's wisdom. And in that wisdom, while you are offering the help, you also say, can I testify about my life to you? Can I give you my testimony? How I came to know the Lord? Then you show you knew the Lord, and you tell that individual that that salvation is also available for him. Or you can just share a scripture and say, today I came across a scripture in the Word of God. Have you read the Bible before? Do you know this kind of scripture? Then you bring that scripture out. And if that child says, that's interesting, I never had that before. Now you will not quote a verse that is well known. Because if you say, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, and then you go on and on, the child will say, well, everybody knows that. I had that before. But if you say, have you had this before? I just read it. A companion of fools shall be destroyed. And it says, where is that? And then you now begin to talk about the companion of fools and what it means. And you lead them to salvation. And then you say, I read this verse. Have you come across this one before? Let not the one that is putting up the harness, that is finishing the work, let not the one that is putting on, just starting, rejoice as the one putting up, as the one finishing. And then he says, where is that in the Bible? Or if you say that sin is crouching at the door. He says, I've never seen that before. Now, you, because they're curious, children are curious, and they're inquisitive, therefore you bring up something to that child that the child will be curious to know and say, I've never seen that, I've never met that. And then from there now, you go on with the scripture. If you are going to evangelize young people like yourself, you have to be wise. And then you do it in simple language. And then you do it when that child is not with other people that will mock, that will ridicule, that you criticize. You do it in such a way that the child will be able to receive. But now a trap you must avoid. As a girl, you will not be talking very often to a boy, because the boy is not going to be thinking about Christ. The boy will be thinking about you. The boy will think that indirectly you are looking for a boyfriend. And you are just using this preaching thing to cover up that really you are looking for him. It is not that Christ is looking for him. That's why as a girl, you'll preach to girls like yourself. That's why as a boy too, you'll preach to boys like yourself. Because if you as a boy will go to a girl, every time, the girl is going to think at the back of her mind, you are not really preaching the gospel. You are not wanting me to come to Christ. You are looking for a girlfriend. Now the second part of your question. Now suppose some other young people have perished already. And the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 3. Ezekiel chapter 3. Reading from verse 17. Let's open the Bible and see the word of God. Son of man, I've made you a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word at my mouth and give them warning from me. When I say to the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speaketh to warn the wicked of his wicked way to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at your hand. You are now asking, if a young believer had been neglecting the preaching of the gospel, and after neglecting the preaching of the gospel, some people have died already. And those people, they are perished. Will their blood be required at your hand if you repent? Of course, if you repent, their blood will no more be required at your hand. Because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 8, look at it, Hebrews chapter 8, verse 12. For I will be merciful to their righteousness and their sins, and their iniquities I will remember no more. Once God has forgiven you, then the Lord will pardon you, and he will not remember those iniquities against your life anymore. Now you're asking the third question, what if, as a child of God, you backslide? If you backslide, and you want to come back to the Lord, will the Lord receive that backsliding child again? Is that the third part of your question?
No, sir. I said that maybe you have preached in time past or and you backslided, that if you repented and you were restored, that will there still be a crown for that person?
Why are you interested in the crown?
Because the Bible says that it's only those that overcome will receive the crown of life. And it's not good for us, maybe if after we have labored, that we will miss all our rewards like that. That's what I want to know.
Thank you very much. That question, you may not know, is very, very difficult to answer a child. That kind of question. I'll tell you why it's very difficult. Now, we know about backsliding generally, and we know about the grace of God. We know about the love of God. We know about the goodness of God. And so we tell everyone, we tell the young people, and we tell also the adults that if a person backslides, he should come back to the Lord, because the grace of God is still available for a child, for a man, for a woman to come to the Lord. So far, so good. Now, take a child that never knew anything of the world, because this child has not been born again. This child is in the kingdom of God and loves the Lord and is serving the Lord. But maybe something happens, and this child decides that although I've been serving the Lord, I've been working for the Lord, I've been bringing other people to the Lord, my talents have been used for the Lord, but now I think I want to backslide, and I want to taste the world a little. After all, God is a wonderful God. If I backslide, and I go away and have fresh air, have some liberty to myself. All these, don't sit down, don't stand up, don't talk, keep quiet, don't do this, don't go that way. I want to be free for some time. And that child becomes free for some time. Now, when the child is away from the Lord, if that child is coming back later, that child can still be forgiven. But while away from the fold, if that child gets into bad company, and then they get into violence, and they get into whatever it is, like on the football field, and they begin to run, and while running, he breaks his leg. Although when he comes back, God will forgive him, he will come back with broken legs. He'll come back with not the whole body, half of the body. If a child goes back to the world, and that child decides that, well, I want to enjoy myself, and gets into boyfriend, girlfriend immorality, and while there she catches AIDS or venereal disease, if she comes back to the Lord will forgive her, but she will have that forgiveness, and the pain and the suffering of AIDS will be there. If that child says, well, I don't like all these, sit down, stand up, and everything, I want my liberty, and then she goes for liberty outside, and eventually a boy comes along, because, somebody who has been in the church does not know the ways of the world, and this boy comes along and says, how are you? I didn't know that you two could join us. Well, I'm free now. Are you really free now? How about being my girlfriend? Well, I'm not born again at present, and no church, no pastor, no leader is going to tell me do this or don't do that. And eventually they get into relationship together, she becomes pregnant and has a child. And eventually that boy will kick her off and get another girlfriend. When that girl repents and says, I want to come back to the Lord, she will come back to the Lord, but with an illegitimate child. And everybody will be seeing her carrying a child. And the people are going to think that she is married already. And she said, they are going to be slow. They are not going to say, I want to marry you, I want to marry you. And when she eventually gets married, she is going to have the problem of taking care of that baby. Because the husband now is going to say, I want us to have our own baby. Think of what you are going to do with that child. Although when you backslide, God will take you back. But the scar of the injury that you caused yourself at the time you backslide, that scar can remain with you for life. And you can suffer in an untold manner because of your foolish going away from the Lord and then coming back. But the Lord will forgive. But you might have to carry the burden and the shame and the pain and the load and the heartache and the higher responsibility of what you have drawn to yourself in the days of backsliding. That's why we tell young people, be very careful. You have God has saved you from a lot of things. And if you get back into the world, you may get to the bottom of the gutter. And before you come back, all through your life, you may regret you ever went away from the Lord. Now, if you come back to the Lord, will you have a crown? Well, it's only God that can decide that. Because you see, we're not in the council of God. We're not in the committee with God. God has called you, like he called Joseph at his early age, like he called Daniel at his early age, like he called Samuel at an early age. And God had a particular thing for that child to do. And that child went away from the Lord. Before coming back, the Lord will not wait for that person for his work to be done. The Lord might put another person to do that thing. And now you come back, and we don't know what age you come back. You might come back at a time when you've lost your voice, you've lost your reputation, you've lost your ability, you've lost everything the Lord actually wanted to use, and then you bring broken body, half of your time, one quarter of the time that remains. You give that to the Lord now. God will receive you, but whether he will still give you a crown or not, when we get over there, we'll be able to tell. The prodigal son came back. And when the prodigal son came back, the father was very happy. And the father rejoiced, and everybody was rejoicing. The older boy, the older child that didn't backslide, that didn't leave home, he was waiting outside. He said, why has my father done this? This child that has wasted his time, wasted his talent, wasted everything, has come back now and you are rejoicing. What did the father say? The father said, yes, let's rejoice. He was dead, is now alive. Lost, but he's found. But you know what he said more? He said, my child, you have always been at home. Don't worry. Everything I have is for you. He has nothing left except just the life. Dead, but alive. And that's why we're rejoicing. And it's lost, but found. That's why we're rejoicing. But everything that I have doesn't belong to both of you anymore. It belongs to you. Be very careful, children. If you know the Lord now, what a great opportunity that now you know the Lord. Don't backslide. Stay with the Lord. If you backslide, if you come back, depending on what time you come back, depending on whether there is anything for you to do when you come back, you might be able to do something. But obviously, you will not receive a full reward like you would have received if you were serving the Lord continually. Why don't we just rise up and pray instead of looking for another question? And let's encourage our children, our young people, know the Lord in the days of your youth. Remember the Lord while you're still young. Let's call upon the Lord that God himself will help our young people, will help all our youth, so that they will not leave the Lord, they will not backslide from the Lord. There is suffering in the world. a lot of pain in the world. If you go back into the world, we don't know what may happen before you come back. The best security for a child, after that child has known the Lord, is to remain with the Lord. That's the way we can assure you of the blessing of the Lord, of the reward on the last day. Going away from the Lord, nobody will give you your assurance that you will ever come back. Because you don't just come back when you like to come back. Your heart may become hardened. The devil may make you blind. The world may harden your conscience. While you are with the Lord, stay with the Lord, remain with the Lord. If you stray away from the Lord, the grace of God is there, but who knows whether you will ever be able to come back. And those of us who are adults, let's take care of the children. Let's take care of the young people. And please don't do anything that will cause their backsliding. In Jesus' name we pray.
Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for the solemn moment of coming to hear your word. We're asking, O Lord, that your Spirit will breathe afresh upon the word today, so we can see afresh what you call us to as your children, in Jesus' name. We pray that as we listen to your word today, we will not regard it as the words of men, but as your word, as it is in truth and reality. And we pray that your Spirit will write with words of fire in every heart, so that this word will burn deep into every heart in Jesus' name. Make us what you want us to be. Help us by your grace to do what you want us to do, so that on the final day there will be a reward from you. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. In Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Luke chapter 6, verse 46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? It's a concern in the heart of the Lord that those who know him as Lord, those who recognize him as Lord, those who accept his authority and control over their lives will do exactly as he has said. And that we will look at all the commandments of God, everything he requires from us, and do it with all our heart, with all our mind, because we own him and accept him as Lord. And whenever he finds among us anyone owning him, declaring him to be Lord, and yet not being obedient continually and consistently to his word, it surprises him and it pains him at his very heart. And he asks the question, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and yet you do not do the things which I say? In 1 Samuel chapter 15, 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22, and Samuel said, as the Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. Here the Lord expressed the same thing to a man to a king in Israel. This king was willing to sacrifice. This king was willing to do quite a lot of things, except totally, completely, fully and wholeheartedly obeying the voice of the Lord. And so the Lord, telling him the same thing that we have read in Luke chapter 6, that the Lord delights in obedience. Obedience from the people that own him as Lord. Obedience from the people that yield to his control. He said he has delight in obedience more than in offerings and sacrifices. And therefore he says, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen to the word of God, hearken to the word of God, and put yourself under the yoke and the control of the word of God is better than the fat of rams. And then he tells us in verse 23, for rebellion, that's another word for disobedience. Disobedience or rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft and stubbornness. Headiness is as iniquity and idolatry. And then the word came, the sentence came, the judgment came, because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord. He has also rejected thee from being king. What we are talking about this morning is something of the greatest import. That is, the greatest importance. I'm talking on Christian parents' highest responsibility. The highest responsibility of Christian parents. Every parent has tremendous responsibility from God. We shall one day give account how we have obeyed the responsibility or kept to that responsibility, or how we have neglected the responsibility. We have children, and there are duties that the Lord himself has laid upon us as parents. And in comparison with any other thing we may be doing, and any other thing we may do in life, our care, our concern, our compassion for our children form the basis of the highest responsibility we have got from the Lord. Our children are first of all human beings. And because they are human beings, they have basic needs that need to be fulfilled. These children, as human beings, they need clothing, they need shelter, and they need some normal things. These, even the sinners, will provide for their children. And if that is all we provide, the Lord is asking the question, what do ye more than others? Providing clothes, even sinners provide clothes for their children. Food, even sinners provide food for their children. And doing that and stopping there, the Lord is asking, you've not done much, you've not done anything beyond what the sinners as well do. What do ye more than others? If we do not provide clothing, food, shelter, the things that sinners provide for their children, let's go a step further, the things that animals provide for their offspring. If you go by the name Christian, if you go by the name church man or church woman, and you do not provide for your children the food and the shelter that even animals provide for their offspring, you understand then why the Bible says you are worse than infidels. You are worse than brute beasts. Because what the animals provide, you cannot even provide. And what sinners provide for their children, you don't even care to provide. And you shouldn't have any false hope of heaven. Now, the children are not only human beings, they are rational beings. They are social beings. And therefore, as social beings and rational beings, they need good relationship. They need good interaction. and they need development of their mind, and they need basic education. As human beings, normal, physical, natural people, they need food. Even animals need food. And they need shelter. Even animals need shelter. That is just because they have some physical needs. But now we are beyond the animals. We are rational beings. We are beyond the animals. We are social beings. Because of that, we need good relationship. We need interaction. We need basic education and the development of the mind. Once again, we need to notice that all these things we must provide to make a difference between us and the brute beasts in the forest. And these things are provided by unbelieving parents, even atheists, who do not believe in God at all. They do not believe there is God anywhere, but they have children. They give them education. They try to develop their mind. And they try to relate with those children. They do not abandon those children in a corner, in a shrine, in a separated room, in an isolated place. Even atheists who do not believe in God, they have interaction, they have relationship, and they give education to their children. And of course, the regular, normal unbelievers and the sinners, they give all these things to their children. Once again, I want to remind you, if that is all you provide, good education, development of the mind, and interaction and relationship between you and your children. If you give all that and you stop, you are not better than an atheist, because atheists also do that. The people who don't believe in the existence of God, they also give that. And sinners do that. And the Lord is asking the question once again in Matthew chapter 5, verse 47. What do ye more than others? The thing in the Christian life is to find out what makes you different. Why do you say you are a child of God? What are you giving to your children that atheists are not giving to their children? What are you giving to your children that sinners are not giving to their children? Now, the peculiarity of the Christian man and the Christian woman is that he knows the children not just as physical human beings, number one, not just as rational national beings, number two, and not just as social beings, number three, but now as immortal beings. That's what makes the difference. Because you know there is an eternity ahead of the children. There are everlasting ages stretched out before the children. That makes the difference in your thinking. You know that these children are never dying souls. And when their bodies die, their souls will not die. And then they will face an eternity, whether in heaven or in hell. And therefore, you take their conversion very serious. And it is the conversion and the care of their never dying souls that is your highest responsibility. That means towards them you have a responsibility. You know that these children will live forever. Will they live in heaven? Will they live in hell? Will they be with God at last? Or will they be with the devil at last? That is your concern. And because of that, you have compassion upon them. You are caring for their never dying souls. The neglect of their souls may even damn your own soul in hell forever. Think about it. If you're a bachelor, you have your soul to answer for. Just your soul. If you are a parent, you have your soul and the souls of your children to answer for at the final judgment day. And the loss of the souls of your children may damn your own soul in eternity. That's why it's very important as we're looking at these three things today. Number one, God's command. Number two, God's condemnation. Number three, God's commendation. Number one, God's command for all parents. God's command for all parents. Number two, God's condemnation for negligent parents. God's condemnation for negligent parents. And number three, God's commendation for dutiful parents. Number one, the command of the Lord. What does he expect from you as a parent? What does he expect from me as a parent? You are a father, you are a mother, you have a responsibility. You have been responsible for bringing that child into the world, either before you were married or after you were married. If you brought a child into the world before you got married, you have responsibility over that child. And that child, whatever you do now, and whatever you do for your other children, if that other child is lost, you're going to be asked a question. And if you close your mouth on the final day, you are not able to answer, your salvation, your security, your eternity will be called into question. You're a woman and you have brought a child into the world. Before you were born again, you have not married the father. And a child is in between. It's neither with the father nor with the mother. It's neither in the other home or in this home. And a child is just roaming about on the street. You're going to answer the question concerning that child. The children you bring into the world, whether outside of marriage or inside of marriage, you have a great responsibility over them. Not only that, now you think about those who have married. And you have brought children into the world. The Lord is commanding you as a father. The Lord is commanding you as a mother. That you have a responsibility over those children. And please, please remember that the loss of the souls of those children may put your own soul in danger on the final day. It's a very great responsibility. God's command for all parents. In Ephesians chapter 6. Reading from verse 4. Ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Here we have the commandment of the Lord. And it tells us first what not to do. What we are not to do by our behavior, by our relationship. What we are not to do by the way we deal with those children. It says, provoke them not to wrath. You will make sure that in your behavior, in your interaction with them, you are not deliberately annoying them, deliberately making them angry, deliberately provoking them, and deliberately tempting them to run away from home. Provoke not your children to wrath. And then it tells us on the positive side now what we're supposed to do. It says, bring them up. Bring them up. That means they are down. They know nothing. Bring them up. That means they are falling. Well, the fallen human race. Bring them up. That means they have the fallen nature. The nature of Adam. They have the fallen nature. The nature of sin. And they are down there, far away from God on high. Bring them up. Make sure that you bring them up with the grace of God. You bring them up with the power of the gospel. You bring them up with the teaching of the scripture. The only thing that can bring a fallen man up, the only thing that can bring a fallen man out of the dungeon of sin, out of the gutter of sin, where that person has fallen, is the gospel of grace, the gospel of the word of the Lord. And it says, bring them up. How are you to do that? In the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. First of all, in the nurture of the Lord, with the word of God, you are nursing them. Like you nurse a baby, and you are giving them the word regularly in morning devotion. You are giving them the word regularly, even during the day. You are giving them the word as to converse together, as to talk together. Everything that you do together, you are nursing them. You are helping them to understand the word of God. And then it says, in the admonition of the Lord, not in the admonition of man. You are not filling their minds with the proverbs and the principles and the precepts of men. But you are admonishing them. You are teaching them. You are instructing them. You are leading them in the way of the Lord. Admonition of the Lord. You look at the word of God. You look at the commandments of the Lord. You look at the precepts in the word of God. And through that word of God, you are giving them admonition. And you do it with the authority of a parent. You do it with the love of a parent. You do it with the certainty that you know that what you are reading from the word of God, what you are giving them from the word of God, is a faithful saying and that it cannot be broken. You do it in the admonition of the Lord. You are a representative of the Lord. You do it with the understanding that if the Lord were here himself, my boy, If the Lord was here himself, my girl, this is what the Lord will be telling you. This is the way the Lord will be leading you. This is what the Lord will be commanding you to do. You do it in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. You admonish them, you counsel them, you lead them, you instruct them in the way of the Lord. That's the command of the Lord for parents. And if we are not obeying those commands, he's asking, why do you say you are a Christian? Why do you call me Lord, Lord? And you do not do the things which I have commanded. In Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Reading verse 6. It says, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. First of all, we as parents must have the word of God in our hearts, controlling our hearts, controlling our lives, so that we will not be parents that will tell our children, do as I say, but do not do as I do. We'll be able to tell the children to do exactly as we're doing, to follow our footsteps, that we ourselves, we obey the word of God. By the grace of God, we accepted the authority of the Lord upon our lives. The word of the Lord is in our hearts. And our children can see it very well that we live by the word. And we do everything that the word of God commands. It is out of that example of living as the children of God ourselves that we now teach and instruct our own children to walk in the way of the Lord. In verse 7, thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou sittest, when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Yeah, the Lord even tells us how to do it. He says, you will teach the commandments of the Lord, the things that I've commanded you. You will teach them diligently unto thy children. How do we teach our children? You teach them diligently. You don't teach your children carelessly. As if your heart is not there. As if your mind is not there. You are in a hurry to rush out. And you're only giving them these things just to fulfill duty. And just to do what you are called upon to do. Your heart is not there. Your mind is not there. Other things are taking your attention. And the child is not important in your sight. You are only hearing, and you are not willing to give the child what it takes. Now in Deuteronomy chapter 6, I'm reading verse 7 again. It says, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. That means then your mind will be there. It means you are not just teaching the word of God to your children in a careless manner, in a careless attitude. With your mind not being there, you want to go somewhere, you want to go and do another thing, and yet the souls of your children are so very important. Therefore, you'll be diligent about it. You put all your mind, you put all your heart into it. And then it says, thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house. You will talk of that word of God with your children. You will not be telling the fables of old women. You will not be talking about the parables, about the proverbs of the nation. But it is the word of God when you are sitting at home with your children. It will be the word of God. And it says, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down and risest up. There are parents that will say they want to buy television. And the reason they want to buy television, they tell us, it's not because of themselves. They want to keep their children busy. They do not have the time to teach their children. They do not have the time to instruct their children or to lead their children in the way of the Lord. But they want the television to make them sit down at home and soak in that thing and suck that thing from the television. You are destroying your children, and you are trying to abandon your responsibility. What the Lord has told you to do, you think that television will be able to do it for the children. They will never be able to do it. They will corrupt your children and destroy your children. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, Deuteronomy chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 18. Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul, and bind them for a sign upon your hand, and that they may be as spotless between your eyes. And ye shall teach them your children, speaking of them, when thou sittest in the house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, when thou risest up. You see what the Lord wants us to do? He wants us to be so diligent to the teaching of the word of God to our children, that whether you are rising up, or you are lying down, or you are sitting down, you are eating together, you are talking together, what will form the basis of your discussion with those children, instruction to those children, everything you do with those children will be the word of God that you are teaching them every time. What will be the blessing of doing such a thing? In verse 21, that your days may be multiplied, and the days of your children in the land which the Lord swear unto your fathers to give them, as the days of heaven upon the earth. Underline that in your Bible, as the days of heaven upon the earth. The days of heaven upon the earth. You see what the Lord is saying? If you want to have peace and joy and blessing, and the very joy of heaven here on earth, you must train your children. You must lead them in the way of the Lord. That's what the Lord will see. He will bring blessing upon your life. In Proverbs chapter 22. Proverbs chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 8. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. You find many people saying that they train their children, and then they departed from it. You didn't train your child. You didn't do it diligently. You didn't talk about it when you were lying down, when you were rising up. You didn't do it with the Spirit of God. And you didn't do it with the grace of God. You didn't do it with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. You didn't live out the example before the child. Maybe you took the child to church. Maybe you took the child to what you call Sunday school in those days. And now you are saying, I taught those children. We did everything for them. You didn't do everything for them. You didn't train them in the way of the Lord and make sure that they got saved and they remained in that salvation. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And remember once again that if the souls of those children are lost, your own soul will be in danger on the final day. In John chapter 14, John chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 15. If ye love me, keep my commandments. If we say we love the Lord, here is one commandment that we have to keep. You will make sure that you train your children. You bring up your children in the way of the Lord. And how many people are saying they are even working in the church, and they are laboring in the church. They even say they are doing evangelism. They even say they want to go on missions. They want to do a lot for the kingdom of God. They want to do a lot in preaching, jumping here and there. And they want to pray for other people, deliver other people. They want to be in this area and be in this other area. They are not teaching their children. They are not leading their children in the way of the Lord. And you do not love the Lord, you might pretend, I fast a lot, I read the Bible a lot, I pray a lot, I read everything I can get about those foreign places because I want to go and preach to them. I love the Lord so much. No, you don't love the Lord. If you are neglecting your children, if your children are not born again, if your children are wayward and you are not concerned about it, you do not love the Lord. It says, if ye love me, keep my commandments. The first commandment you have to keep is the commandment of training your children after you have been born again. There are some people that say, well, it's because I'm in the work of the Lord. Listen, that work of the Lord, if it takes the training of your children away from you, you will not even be rewarded for that work. In this church, many people sometimes they don't understand, and it's because they don't understand the scriptures. Many years ago, we stopped married women from coming on full time so that they can take care of their children, because we saw that the demand of full time in the church was so much on them they couldn't train their children. Therefore we said, please, we're just going to have men, we'll keep you at home so that you can train your children. Of course, some people did not understand at that time. We're trying to save them from perishing. We're trying to save them from the judgment of God coming upon them. Now we have some full-time women in the children's section because that's peculiar to women. And in the women's section because it's peculiar to women. But, if you work there in the children's section, I mean full-time now, and you work there in the women's section, I mean full-time now, takes you away from home so much, you cannot even train your children. And the father is not there to train the children, will rather stop that individual so that the judgment of God will not come upon you. You must give time to train your children. The same thing, those who are working maybe as coordinator, as zonal leader, you are working as women reps, you are working as women coordinator in the church, and you're always away from home. Your responsibilities, you do not know how to balance your time and spend time with your children and train your children. You say you are leading other people to heaven, your children are going into hell. You rather stop that thing you are doing and then go back home and take care of your children. Otherwise, the judgment of God will be upon you that you do not love the Lord and you are not obedient to the word of the Lord. In John chapter 15 and in verse 10, if ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. If we keep the commandments of the Lord, then are we abiding in the love of the Lord. We go to point number two, the condemnation from the Lord for negligent parents. Negligent parents, the people who abandon their children, they leave their children in the hands of the devil. They leave their children to go to the nightclubs. They leave their children to be roaming about in the street. They leave their children to be going to the other houses to be learning the bad practices of other children in the community. They leave their children, mother is away from home, father is away from home. They leave their children sometimes to fall into the well, or sometimes to drink dirty water, or sometimes to take in things that are evil. They leave their children, they have gone to market, they have gone to trade, they have gone to office, they have gone everywhere. They leave their children in the hands of a handmaid that is teaching their children about witchcraft, about sorcery, about occultism, about evil things. They leave their children in the hands of other children in the community, leading them to fornication and immorality at a very early age. They leave their children in the hands of the community people, teaching them how to steal, how to do wicked things. And they say, well, it's because I'm laboring for the children. I'm trying to get money so that I'll be able to take care of these children. The money you get and you give them food, it will not make you to do anything that, because if that's all you do, you are not more than an animal. You are not more than a sinner. It is a salvation. It is a conversion experience. It is a life of Christ you give to those children that make you different from the unbelievers outside. Now, if you don't take care of your children, if your children are not born again, whoever you are, a preacher, a leader, a worker, a teacher, whatever it is, if you neglect your child, the care of your children, the conversion of your children, what's the condemnation? What's the damnation? What's the judgment of God upon such negligent parents? Look at 1 Samuel chapter 2. 1 Samuel chapter 2 in verse 12. Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord. We don't have any problem in the Bible about the ministry of Eli. That is, about his preaching, about his doctrine, about his attitude, about the worship, about the priesthood. There was no problem raised about his ministry. The only problem raised about Eli was the very fact that his sons were sons of Belial. They did not know the Lord. No salvation, no fear of the Lord, no obedience to the word of the Lord. Look at verse 17. Wherefore, the sin of the young men, the two sons of Eli, was very great before the Lord. For men abhorred and detested and hated the offering of the Lord. The people of Israel, as they looked at the lives of the two sons of Eli, they hated the worship. They hated everything. Not because of Eli himself. We are not told that Eli committed a personal sin. Apart from the fact that he neglected the care of his children and did not lead them in the way of the Lord. Of course, there was a particular time he called them when he heard what they were doing and see the way he tried to correct them. In verse 22, now Eli was very old and heard all that his sons did unto all Israel and how they lay with the women that assembled at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. Now you see how far they went. As the women were coming to make their sacrifices, as the women were coming to worship the Lord, the sons of Eli that were supposed to be leading these people in the way of the Lord, taking their sacrifices from them, offering them upon the altar, they will commit immorality, not even secretly now, right in the open. It was that bad. And Eli heard how many people today were doing everything we can and we're winning people to the Lord. It may be the son of a coordinator that is writing love letter to the girls that we're bringing to the church. It may be the girls, the daughters of a coordinator, of a zonal leader, of a particular worker in the church that is accepting love letters and making some private arrangement to go and be with a boy and get pregnant in the church. And these parents are still walking and serving and jumping up and down, not knowing that the judgment of God is upon them already, that their work will not be rewarded by the Lord, that their work will not be recognized by the Lord, that although they may say that they are not committing any personal sins themselves, yet if your children, if they are spoiling the word of the Lord and they are turning the grace of God upside down, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness, and you're still busy and busy and busy, you will be under the judgment of the Lord. In verse 23, and he said unto them, why do you such things? That you see like now, talking to his own children, why do you do all these things? For I hear of your evil dealings with all these people. Nay, my sons, for it is no good thing, no good report that I hear. Ye make the Lord's people to transgress. The Eli even recognized that they were causing people who were saved before, they were making them to backslide. And Eli told his children, the report I'm hearing about you, you are causing the people of the Lord to backslide, to transgress, and to sin against the Lord. But he never removed them. He never disciplined them. He just remained, he let them remain there, still going on with the sacrifices. Adultery was going on, fornication was going on, immorality was going on by his children. And yet at the same time, service was going on, ministration was going on, sacrifices were going on, the priesthood was going on. Sin, they were trying to atone for the sins of the people by the sacrifices. And they were the people that were leading those people into sin. And because of that, eventually, the judgment of God came upon Eli. And there are people that their children are like that. And sometimes it takes a boldness to be a pastor in a church. Any church, whatever. And in a church like Deeper Life, it takes courage and boldness to really be a pastor. The reason I'm saying that is that you people in the church, you have a tendency and you have a way of doing things that will make the pastor to suffer and not to follow the word of God anymore. And then the judgment of God will come upon me. The reason I say that, I will tell you now. In one of our states, we discovered that the son of the overseer there was not living right. And it was so very, very bad that it was so bad that the campus people were complaining about the child of that person. But the overseer there will not discipline the child, will not do anything. Eventually, I heard about it and I had to discipline the man. Because if I didn't discipline him, God will discipline him. And the discipline of man is better, it's easier, it's simpler than the discipline of Almighty God. And then after I disciplined him, he started saying, what have I done? I didn't do anything. It's my child. I did what he did. That's my child's problem. Eventually, he left deeper life and then now has another ministry because, you know, we stopped him because of his child. If they're going to be doing like that, I will leave. And other people told me, they came to me and they said, Pastor, why don't we, you know, do this thing with wisdom? I said, there's no other wisdom. The only wisdom is the word of God. They said, but the people are living. I said, yes, but I have to keep to the word of God. And the same thing happened in Lagos. One coordinator in one of the language churches, his child fought openly. I mean, real fighting with the wife of the head usher in that, their local church around us here. And then we heard about it where the coordinator was called and said, see what your daughter has done. Real fighting. I mean, real fighting like in the world outside the church with the wife of the head usher over there. And then we said, this is not right. We said, therefore, you coordinator, the father, go and sit down a little bit. The following Sunday, he started a church in his own house with his daughter fighting and with his own wife and with some people, little people around there. He's taking them to hell and he himself is planning to go to hell. We have to discipline people when in the church we find out that your child is not living right. Because if we don't do that, the judgment will come upon us. And you are not in deeper life, so you'll be a coordinator. You are not in deeper life, so you'll be a state overseer. You are not in deeper life, so you'll be a region overseer. You are in deeper life, so you will learn the word of God and make heaven at last. If you are not willing to take the rebuke and the correction of deeper life and of the word of God, and you say, if they rebuke me, I will go. Why don't you go even from this morning? Because you are not a child of God. A person who is a child of God will like rebuke, will like correction, because it is that correction and admonition that will take us to heaven. Otherwise, we'll be sending me to hell myself. And I don't want to go to hell, and I will not get to hell in Jesus' name. If the backsliders want to go, let them go so I can get to heaven. And so you see here, Eli did not correct his children. And because he did not correct his children, you see the judgment that came upon such an individual. You have God's condemnation for negligent parents. Now in Proverbs chapter 17. I'm reading from verse 25. Proverbs 17:25. A foolish son is a grief to his father and bitterness to her that bear him. You see, if you are a foolish child, it means that you are going to be a grief of heart, a sorrow of heart to your parents, to your father, or to your mother. And you parents, fathers, and mothers, if you are serious on other things now, your child has just been born and your child is very young, you never get home in time. You never take care of your children. Those children are going to grow up without knowing your authority, without knowing that you have anything to contribute to their lives. And if you continue like that and you are negligent, you will not be able to have the blessing that God wants you to have. That's why the Bible says very clearly, there is sorrow, there is heaviness, there is grief, there is judgment, there is condemnation for the parents that do not have wise, converted children. In 1 Kings, we're reading chapter 1, 1 Kings chapter 1, reading from verse 5 and in verse 6, we'll see something that Solomon did and it became heartache for him. In 1 Kings chapter 1, reading from verse 5, then Adonijah, the son of Agi, exalted himself, saying, I will be king, and prepared him chariots and horsemen and 50 men to run before him. Here we find David. David apparently was a good king. David apparently was a good prophet. And David apparently was a good man, because he was a man after God's own heart. But he had a problem. He was very, very weak in his family, in dealing with his children. You know that Absalom, the third child, was the one that tried to chase him away from the throne even before the time of his death. And Absalom was the one that arranged, because of something that had happened, he arranged that another child of David would be killed. And he murdered that child and David couldn't do anything. Here we have another child again now, Adonijah. a child, a son to David. It says that he set people around him, he prepared the chariot, and David had not died, and David had not said that he will reign. The young man was looking for position. And then he said he was going to reign. Then we are told in verse 6, the real problem was David in training his children in verse 6. And his father had not displeased him at any time, saying, "What hast thou done?" A child you cannot rebuke. A child you never rebuke. A child you never say, "Why did you do that?" And then the child will frown. And once the child frowns, then you are afraid of the child. You cannot talk again. That was the thing that brought ruin and destruction upon the house of David. And then the Lord has told us that he will bring terrible judgment upon you and upon the children if you reject the knowledge of the Lord, and if you are not teaching your children, leading your children in the way of the Lord. In Hosea chapter 4, reading from verse 6. "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I also will reject thee." That's a serious matter. "Because you have rejected knowledge, I also will reject thee." And then it says that thou shalt be no priest unto me. And then it says that thou shalt be no priest unto the Lord, because seeing that you have forgotten the law of thy God, I also will forget thy children. If you forget the law of the Lord, you forget the word of the Lord, and you say, "Well, I know the Bible says to correct the children, to chastise the children, to beat the children, and to train the children, and to instruct the children. But I'm such a weak person, I cannot do that. I cannot bear the crying of a child. And if I beat them, they are going to cry. Because of that, I will leave them alone. If they do well, good luck. If they don't do well, good luck. I have my life to live. They have their own life to live." It says, because you have rejected the commandments of the Lord. And what the Lord has told you to do, you are not willing to do. "I will reject you, that ye shall be no priest unto me." If we find that you are rejecting the word of God, then we're going to take you away from the ministry. You cannot continue to serve the Lord, preaching to other people, praying for other people, singing for other people to hear, when you are not abiding by the word of the Lord. "Because you have rejected his word, you will be no priest unto me." That's the word of God we're following. And if you hear that anybody comes under discipline, that's the reason. That if a person rejects the authority, the control, the instruction of the word of God, we don't count anybody in this church so indispensable that even when he backslides, he must keep on ministering. And even when he is not training his children, he must keep on ministering. When his children are committing fornication, adultery, and they are stealing, hear all about in the district, in the community, he must keep on preaching. Nobody is so indispensable like that. The word of God says, because they have rejected his word, there will be no priest unto him. How about those their children? He will forget their children. I pray God will have mercy upon us. And I pray that all the things that are wrong in our families, we will correct in Jesus' name. And then we'll be able to have the commendation of the Lord. That leads us to point number 3, God's commendation for dutiful parents. God's commendation for dutiful parents in Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18, reading from verse 19. Here we find the Lord praising Abraham because of what he did, because he knew and he gave assurance that he will teach his own children in Genesis 18:19, "For I know him, that he will command his children and his household after him." Do you see that? He will command his children and even his household after him. And he says, "And they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken of him." You see why the blessing of God came upon Abraham. While the Lord said, "He is a man that is his friend," Abraham, the friend of God. And one of the reasons is that he said, "I know him. He will teach his children. He will command his children and his household." so that they will obey the word of the Lord. Can the Lord say that about Pentecostal preachers, charismatic preachers, evangelical preachers, deep life preachers, that we will give time, that charity begins at home, that preaching begins at home, that the grace of God should be revealed at home, that honesty, holiness, humility, the life of God in man, of a new creature, should start at home? Are we taking care of our children? Or are we neglecting our children, abandoning our children, just to behave any way they want? And they are not saved, they are not born again, and we do not care for it. And even when they come for Christian programs in the church, and it appears that they have gotten something, they get home and their parents cannot follow up on them to deepen the knowledge of the things they have got. In Joshua chapter 24, Joshua chapter 24 and in verse 15. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You see this, Joshua, old man at this time now, he decided he will serve the Lord, not only serve the Lord in isolation, he will serve the Lord with all his house. And that's very important, that you as a father, you'll take a decision this morning together with your wife, the mother of the children, and you'll get the children together and you'll say, this house will serve the Lord. And it will not just be a Sunday decision, a one day decision. It's going to be something you are going to continue to do. Morning devotion there, or family also there, and sharing with the word of God there, teaching the word of God in that family. And even if the people, the leaders among the youth were not doing their work effectively, you will know that you are bringing up your own child or your own children in the way of the Lord, so that when the Lord will come, your children will not be lost. They will not go to heaven, and they will not go to hell while you go, while you think you are going to heaven. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, 2 Timothy chapter 1, reading from verse 5, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwells first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded that is in thee also. You see that faith was in the mother. We don't have the mention of the father. Maybe the father was not born again, but the mother was born again. The grandmother was born again. Because of that, the mother and the grandmother, they did something for Timothy, and they led that Timothy in the way of the Lord. And that unpretending faith, that real faith, that sure faith, then was in that child Timothy. Eventually, Paul the apostle met him, and he added his own bit. And wonderful things began to take place in the life of that Timothy, and then that wonderful thing continued now in ministry in the life of that child that now grew up to be a young man and became a servant of the Lord later. It's very important that we take these words of God to heart. We've been saying it before, but it appears that some people do not understand, and some people are not following the word of God. But I pray that from this morning, all of us will become serious with the word of God in Jesus' name. And we will know that the care of our children, after you have been saved, after you are born again, the care of your children, the concern, the compassion, and the conversion of your children, they come first in your ministry. If you are trying to minister here, minister there, do this here, do this there, do not know the Lord, lessen all those activities, stop all those activities, and come to the Lord, and then say, oh Lord, sorry, repent before the Lord. Because right now, if your house is not in order, if your children are not following the way of the Lord, there is judgment already hanging upon you and hanging upon your family. If you will come in repentance and call upon the Lord, and then you'll put yourself into the duty that you need to perform, I believe that God will be merciful. The Lord will forgive you, and then you'll be able to start afresh and do something necessary for your children. Last year we stopped some of the leaders that were having problems at home, that their children were not doing well. And some people understood, some did not understand. I was so shocked and surprised last week when a coordinator came to me and said, "Sir, we need your help." I said, "What help do you need?" And he said, "Well, we have a women rep. After she had your message last year about having children that are wayward, children that are not doing well, children that are sleeping, children that are causing problems, and she left the world. And I'm trying to encourage her that that's not what the pastor meant. That although your children are bad, although your children are wayward, what the pastor is only saying is that you should take care of the children. The pastor did not mean that we should leave the work of God." I looked at the coordinator and said, "It looks like that woman rep understands the word of God better than you do. It looks like you are misinterpreting the word of God. You are confusing that woman. That woman has done right in leaving the word of God so as to settle down at home and take care of his own child, of her own child. You are the one confusing the woman. You are preaching false doctrine unto her." And then he began to apologize. I said, "So that's what you are doing in the district. People are hearing the word of God. They are rising up to obey the word of God. And then you are confusing them. The pastor did not mean that." The pastor means the word of God. And I teach the word of God. And I want you, if your children are not living right, I want you voluntarily to leave that work. If you don't want to go to hell, take care of your children at home. Bring up your children in the way of the Lord. I tell my own children, and they are here now hearing me, and when they hear, I know that they will know I'm serious about it. I tell them that if there's any time you do something that is scandalous, any time you do anything that shows that you are a sinner publicly, I said you are going to cut off the lifeline from Deeper Life Congregation, because I'm going to leave preaching. I will leave the thing and concentrate. I will do that myself. Not to talk of all the other people. I tell my own family, you should tell your own family so that we will stand on the word of God. Now before we pray, look at Psalm 144. Psalm 144. Reading from verse 12. "That our sons may be as plants grown up in their youth, and that our daughters may be as cornerstones after the similitude of a palace." I pray that our homes will become better. Our children will become better. The lives of our children will become better. And we will get back home from today. And we will take this word of God serious. If you have been preaching in the bus and you are not preaching at home, why don't you stop the bus evangelism and now start home evangelism? If you have been running up and down and you are preaching here, preaching there, you are already an evangelist now, you are preaching, you are having crusade, you are having that. How about having crusade at home? How about doing evangelism at home? How about teaching your children at home? So that your children will come to know the Lord. If my children are born again and your children are born again and all our children are following the Lord, then our children, our sons, will be as plants grown up in their youth, and our daughters will be as cornerstones, and they will be polished after the similitude of the Lord. The Lord has spoken to us this morning. Obviously, he has rebuked us, he has chastised us, he has corrected us. But let the righteous smite me, it shall be ointment upon my head. Do we love the chastisement of the Lord? Do we accept the rebuke of the Lord? Then we should take correction and not remain like Eli. Let's rise up and say, "Lord, we're guilty. Lord, we know we're wrong." No quiet time at home, no family altar, no devotion, no teaching of the word of God. We are not bringing up our children. Our children are wayward. Our children are going astray. Our children are doing the same thing that the children of the worldly people are doing. They are palming. They're using their lipsticks already. They're going to their, they're having their jewelry already. They are fighting already. They are smoking, they are drinking already. And they are watching their television already. They are uncontrollable. And we are not caring about it. We need to call upon the Lord and repent before the Lord. If the souls of those children are lost, your own soul will be in danger. If the souls of these children are lost, your own souls will be in danger. Call upon the name of the Lord, so that you will not perish because of too much activity. Activity that does not allow you to help your children, to train your children, to lead your children in the way of the Lord. Pray and repent before the Lord. Are your children born again? Do your children know the Lord? Do you ever pray with your children? Do you ever teach your children the Word of God? Or do you think you are indispensable? Even though you have wayward children, you think it doesn't matter. Even though you have children that are not born again, you think it doesn't matter. I have a ministry. What ministry do you have that your children have not partaken of? I have a ministry. I must preach. I must evangelize. Why don't you evangelize your children first? If those children are lost, where will you spend eternity? If those children are lost, where will you spend eternity? Seek the face of the Lord. That's the word of God we have heard. Take it as the word of God and not the word of a man. Rebuke, yes. Chastisement, yes. Correction, yes. We need it. We need it. Lest all these religious activities will drown us in the pit of hell. Lead your children, teach your children, instruct your children in the way of the Lord. Train up every child in the way he should go. Then when he's old, he will not depart from it.
I believe you have been blessed. Don't let this message die. Listen to it again and pass it to others. You can get more from God at the Deeper Life Bible Church. Our headquarters is Deeper Life Bible Church, Jagada, Lagos, Nigeria. Blessed are your ears for hearing these things. We'll meet in heaven if you do them.